I'm Philippe Jatkuits, the director and founder of a company here in Maastricht called Vectioneer. And it's getting a little bit technical, so I hope you're still awake. But I know a lot of you are technical people, so I try to be gentle on you, but I'm going a little bit deeper. So what you see behind me is, believe it or not, it's the first flight simulator ever photographed. And it was built in 1910, when airplanes were not so common. But we had a world war, and pilots wanted to train flying skills before they got into the real aircraft. So this is a really rudimentary flight simulator with a motion system. And the motion system was operated by two operators, who actually looked at what the pilot was doing with the controls, the big wheels on the side, and was rocking the barrel so he could give a feel of how it would feel in the air. But they actually had no clue how it would feel in the air. So, but this is a very admirable thing to achieve, because we came a lot starting here. You have to start somewhere. Oh, the clicker. So as was mentioned, I studied at TU in Delft, mechanical engineering with a specialism in mechatronics. And during my studies, we worked on this flight simulator. It was a very advanced flight simulator. You could test all kinds of aircraft in there and also vehicles. And it was being constructed while I did my master's thesis. I worked on the control system of the motion platform. And since then, this has been my life's work, to work on motion systems for simulators, flight simulators or driving simulators. So here are some of the projects I've been part of. This is a truck driver research simulator in Sweden for VTI. They design systems in trucks, and they can use drivers to test the new designs of the trucks. Note how large these motion systems are. So these are research driving simulators. This is an even larger one. It's in China, Tongji University. They also do research into new driving systems for passenger cars, especially adaptive cruise control systems. So they wanted to mimic the brake behavior of a real car. And that's when you need a lot of stroke in your motion system. So these are multi-million dollar or euro systems. So nobody can afford this in the gaming industry yet, but I'll come back to the size of these systems in a later. One of the recent projects we did with the company was to do a new motion control system of a flight simulator for a helicopter simulator for the US Marine Corps. We actually did three of these simulators, and these are one of the biggest systems out there. They can have a payload up to 14 tons, and they have a very big visual system, 360 degrees in all directions. So, and you need that for helicopters, because you need to look up and you need to look down when you land. So these systems are very, very complex and impressive, and a lot of fun to fly too. So when we build flight simulators, we want to transfer training in the simulator to the real aircraft. That is was the original goal. We want to train pilots with dangerous situations that you do not want to train in the real aircraft. So we want to teach them something in a virtual environment that they can apply in the real world. But driving is very different from flying. Driving involves a lot of very sharp, high-frequency accelerations, especially lateral and longitudinal acceleration, which you don't have in the airplane. The airplane kind of glides through the air, and all the turns are coordinated, we call that. So the gravity vector, or the acceleration vector that you feel, is always going straight through the pilot. So you fly in the curve, and you never have your dingly thing wobble as much as in the race car, especially. So that's why we need a lot of big machines in driving simulation, if you want to transfer training from the simulator to the real car. So I have questions about, this is actually a system we built for Toyota in Cologne. They wanted to train drivers how the race car would behave in reality. But actually, the use of the simulator is limited. You can train the driver how the track looks, how he should cut this corner, but he cannot really train his skill, the skill of driving on the edge of the performance of this race car. It's just not possible with this small motion system. You cannot render the same kind of acceleration as you would in the real system, because you would have to leave the room that the simulator is in. The space is not big enough. So it doesn't really transfer from the simulator to the race car. So this is a simulator we also worked on. This was a simulator for the University of Stuttgart, and this is one of the largest in Europe. BMW and Renault are now getting a larger one, so they're being developed. And this is just for passenger cars. So here you see that you need a lot of space and a lot of money to properly simulate a lane change on the highway. That's mostly what they want to do. You go from the left, the right lane to the left lane and back, and they can do this one-on-one, so the car or the simulated car behaves exactly the same as a real car. But for racing, this is, you would need something much, much bigger and much, much more powerful. But that's not the point. We don't want to train drivers. Well, maybe you do want to transfer sim drivers to the real world. But for us, like gamers, we just want to win in the game. So obviously, it transfers from the simulator to the simulator. So if you train in the simulator, do you need motion? And that's what my talk is actually about, is why do we add motion to a simulator? And I think it makes you perform better. People are very adaptive. So even if your behavior changes, maybe this guy had an accident, he cannot walk anymore, he adapts, he was a skater before, he is a skater now because he adapts to the new environment. People are so adaptive, and they use whatever sensor input they can to make their performance better. And that's kind of essential for us humans, and also how we compete in games. So in school, you're taught that we have five senses, which is wrong, but we have these five senses, which are hearing, vision, smell, touch, and taste. But there's actually more. We have more sensors in our body, that, especially motion sensors, that sense motion, the vestibular system, it's your inner ear. You have two of them, left and right. And they can actually sense velocity and acceleration. And then you have the proprioceptive system, it's muscle sense. So I know where my arms are. Even if I close my eyes, I can touch my ear, I can do all kinds of things without even looking at my hands. And that's proprioceptive. And you can even feel acceleration with what, because you need to exert force on your arm because you're accelerated this way. You need to, you feel the force on all your limbs. So with this, you can also feel acceleration. So if you order these senses from slow sensors to fast sensors, you have taste and smell on the left. It's really slow. Maybe you can smell where you are when you come somewhere, but it takes time. Vision is also relatively slow. Then comes hearing. Hearing is actually directly coupled to your motor system. So it's when you hear a sound, you get the startle effect. You immediately react. Your muscles react before you even know that you are frightened. That is, in vision, this process is much more slower because it has to go to the visual cortex, to your brain, and then it goes to the muscles. So this path is slower. Touch is also very fast. Touch a hot plate, and immediately your arm retracts, even before you feel the heat. And vestibular and proprioceptive systems, they can sense acceleration, which is even faster. Because we can balance ourselves. We train ourselves the whole time to balance using our vestibular system. And racing is actually, I'm a control engineer, so I studied mechanical engineering with a specialism in controls and mechatronics. So I look at the world as closed loop systems. And racing is actually a tracking task. This driver has a mental model of the racetrack and the ideal line that he wants to follow. And he wants to stay on this ideal line and be as fast as he can. So he has to use his sensors to feel when he's going close to the edge of the capability of the car. He doesn't want to spin out and lose it. He just wants to be on this edge. So it's a high gain task. So the human is fully engaged. He tries the best he can and follow the line as optimal as he can. So the driver is here in this closed loop system. This is a simulated. So in your simulator, it looks like this. The driver gets inputs from his environment. So everything he sees, smells, feels, and determines what to do next. He looks at the screen and he determines his steering action. Also the pedals and maybe other inputs he can generate. This is processed in a vehicle model. This is a model of the real vehicle that runs on a computer in real time. And this calculates based on the environment, and the environment could be not only the weather, but also the racetrack itself, up to small details, and maybe engine influences on the engine. You lose fuel while you drive, so your car gets lighter. This all changes the vehicle model. So this calculates in real time what the vehicle would have done in real life, and this is then given over to various subsystems, like the audio system makes a sound of the engine and the wind. The instruments show the correct readings, the visual system shows the scene, the control loading system, which is the feel in the steering, will render the forces as they were in the race car, and the motion system moves you around through some filter, because we cannot leave the room, the motion is very limited. So we use motion drive algorithms that kind of scale down the motion and transform it, because we use some tricks that we can use of the visible system, because it cannot really distinguish between acceleration and gravity. But that's another colloquium, I think. So we use all these things to render as best as we can and put that as an input to the driver sensor, so he can be as responsive as he can. And there's an interesting thing about bicycle riding. We all know how to ride a bicycle, probably, especially here in the Netherlands. We are taught very young how to ride a bicycle. But there, imagine that you have a vestibular dysfunction. That means that your equilibrium organ does not function. Do you think you can ride a bicycle? I will answer this question for you. Yes, these people can ride a bicycle, some of them, and they have to really focus, and they have to keep their eyes open, and they watch the road in front of the bicycle up to 2 meters to really get a sense of their attitude. So are they leaning left or right? Because they cannot feel the acceleration. But as soon as they lose vision, so if the lighting is not correct, they fall. So it's very important that you have this, what we think is very, very normal, to have this vestibular cue to be able to ride a bicycle. So we also could use it to drive a vehicle. So we see again a different representation of the slow sensors at the top and the fast sensors at the bottom. And slow is position and orientation. So we can look outside the window, we see the horizon, and we kind of have an idea of how we are oriented with respect to the world. Are we standing upright or not? We also use vestibular system, because as I said, we can sense the gravity. So if I close my eyes, I can still do all kinds of tricks, and I know where my head is, if it's tilted or not. And also my proprioceptive sensors in my neck tell me if my head is twisted or not. Then to sense velocity, which is a faster input, we still can use vision. We call this vection. So you maybe remember Windows had this screensaver where the stars come towards you, and you get the feeling of being sucked into this screen. That is what we call vection. So it's a feeling of self-motion based on visual cues. So we can make an estimation, a rough estimation of our velocity. But this is actually a problem in especially racing simulation, that we underestimate velocity if we use visual cues alone. Also, audio cues give us a very good cue about the velocity. You listen to the engine sound, and you know approximately how fast you're going. So without sound, it's very difficult to guess how fast you are. Rotational velocity is actually difficult to spot with the visual system, except for the roll motion, because we see the horizon move a lot. But if we do yaw, it's very difficult. And when you take a turn, it's a lot of yaw, so you just see these trees go by like this, and it's very difficult to estimate a good velocity of yourself. So we need a motion system actually to render all these fast cues, and especially acceleration. So the change of velocity can only be felt by a motion system or a control loading system. So why do you benefit from this? With motion system, you can actually feel what you cannot see. So you suppose you're in this situation where you're driving just on the edge of the curb and you cannot really see well where the curb is, maybe there's smoke, but you can feel it really well. So you know when you're on the curb and you get this vibration and it startles you and it says, okay, I'm going too far now. So it actually gives you a sense of things you cannot sense otherwise. As I already said, underestimating velocity. That's a problem we experienced. I was in driving simulator in Korea, and the management came and they said, we want to drive this simulator. And they said, well, this feels much too rough. Our cars are very, very smooth. Can you please tune down the feeling of the road? So we tuned it down, and it would feel like you were driving on glass, actually. So you wouldn't feel anything. And then we put other people in the car, and there was there was this test track where they would drive up to a roundabout, and depending on which exit you took, you could go to the racetrack, or you could go to the drag strip, or you could go into the city. And all of them, they overshot this roundabout. They just flew over it because they had no sense of how fast they were going. Nobody was looking at the speedometer. They were actually driving 100 kilometers per hour when they were like 10 meters in front of the roundabout. So they could never make it. And yeah, that's especially this situation. You want to know how fast you're going in a race car because that's win or lose. Another important one is to prevent motion sickness. So I get sick immediately when something's not right. So when the visual cue does not align with my actual motion, I get sick. So I'm the best person to test a flight simulator or motion simulator for false cues, we call that. So the motion is moving this way while the visual moves this way. That's the worst. And adding a little bit of motion and do it correctly, then you can prevent a little bit of motion sickness. And motion sickness is very nasty. It can hit you in a second, so 1 second you're fine, the next second you're puking over a bucket, and it will last for hours, and you're just out of the game. And then, obviously, if you can react faster based on these faster inputs, you actually can drive faster. And that's, of course, the most important in esports. So I would recommend, if you go into esports, try to save a little bit of money, get an upracer. That's a much better setup than just behind your computer screen. And there are all kinds of motion systems. I've shown you very, very big ones. But I believe for sim racing, you could only do with a small system. This is like a medium system. It's built by another company. It's already pretty expensive. But a little bit of motion cue can already help you perform better. And since you're all coming from close by, most of you, I invite you to give us a call. If you're interested in this subject of simulation, we also do robotics control. We are in Maastricht, in the north of Maastricht. I invite you all to let me know and stop by and look at our setups. Thank you very much and enjoy your day.